Please stand. You may be seated. Friends, family, it's good for us to be together today. It's a beautiful day. It's a beautiful time of year. There's a beautiful bride and a beautiful groom. This is a day made beautiful because of what it represents. It represents love. It represents holiness. It represents the presence of God. This is a celebration of family and friends. It's a celebration of love. So it's right for us to begin by asking, who gives this woman to be married to this man?
Her mother and her father.
Well, here we are. We've made it. Everyone's made it here. You've got your dress. You didn't trip up the steps. All the things that you've been worrying about for the last two or three days are nearly over. This is the day you've been looking forward to. It's the day that your parents have been looking forward to and maybe dreading and then looking forward to again some more since you were born. This is an exciting day and it's a great day. I asked your parents last night if they would write down some things to share with you on this special day, and you look nervous. I can't imagine why. We'll start with you, Sandy. Here's what your parents wanted to share with you today. A few things. The first, Sandy, we are grateful that you are no longer on our cell phone plan. They mean that from the bottom of their hearts and the bottom of their wallets. The second thing they wanted to say, Sandy and Justin, Sandy, we truly believe that you are a beautiful, kind, compassionate, loving, and intelligent person. We not only believe that, but we know you will love hearing these words out of the mouth of your brother-in-law. I don't know what that means. This is what else they had to say to you, Sandy. We know that you have had strong friendships and a family that will always be there for you and Justin. May God bless you and both of you in your new lives together. Justin, your parents had some things to share with you too. Justin and Sandy, there's so many things we could say to you today, most of which you've already heard many times before. Just know that as you begin this new phase of your life with Sandy, that our love for you will never end. Put God first, each other second, and your life will be blessed. What encouraging words from family. This is a family day. Love is a lot of things. It's a choice, it's an emotion, it's a feeling, it's an energy, it's a wonderful thing. But I want us to think for a moment about how love is a choice. In our lives, we make many choices, some of them big, some of them little. You made the choice to attend Fried Hardeman, and you made the choice to attend some classes together, and evidently those choices eventually led you to this place today. In life, some of the choices we make have almost no consequences, nothing of significance, but sometimes little choices are made bigger by what they surround and what is influencing them. Sandy, I imagine today you spent more time planning the dress that you would wear than any other outfit on any other day of your life. And Justin, a few months ago, you spent more time researching jewelry probably than any other man ever will again. But why would you spend time in that? Because it represented something bigger, the choice that you had made to love one another. In April, Justin and Sandy came to Nashville for a birthday celebration and a date night. They went to the Cheesecake Factory, and that's a place where there's many difficult choices to be made. And they went on to the beautiful pedestrian bridge that overlooks the Cumberland River and the Nashville skyline. When Sandy was turned around, she turned back around to find Justin on one knee with a ring and a question. If I understand the story right, Justin had to ask the question a second time before he got an answer, but I think the look on her face indicated the choice was already made. It was a decision that you made that brings you to this day. There are lots of people in the Bible who make the choice of love. You know the story of Ruth. There's a woman named Naomi who's widowed after some 10 years of marriage. Naomi told her daughter-in-law Ruth that she was free to go about her life, do what was best for her. She said in Ruth chapter 1, verse 8, "Go, return each of you to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me," she said. "Go back home that you may find rest with your husband." But Ruth was unwilling to abandon her choice of love, even for a mother-in-law. Verse 14 of Ruth 1 says that Ruth clung to her mother-in-law. She wouldn't let go. And she said in verse 16, "Do not urge me to leave you or to turn from following you, for where you will go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord do so to me, and even more, if anything but death parts me from you." We all love that beautiful passage in Ruth. It's become the foundation of most wedding vows, "Till death do us part." She had a choice. She could have sought her own interests. She could have done what was easier and better for her, but love was more important. That was the choice she made. Real love, dedicated love, chosen love is difficult, but it is wonderful. The word passion basically means suffering because you are so dedicated to your choice. True love seeks not its own. It is a great burden, but it is the greatest of blessings. It is love that sent Jesus to the cross. It was love for his Father and for his creation that sent him down the road of sorrows to be scourged, spat upon, and crucified for me and you. That love was not conquered even by death. Justin, that's the sort of love that God commands for you to have for Sandy. In the book of Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1, God says, "Be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us." The message for you, Justin, is in verses 25 to 28 of that text. "Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, so that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the blood, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself." Justin, make the choice to love Sandy. And that passage, if I had to paraphrase it, would say, love her even if it kills you. Love her every day of your life with every decision that you make. As you honor her, you will honor God. Love her in a way that makes your love for God abundantly clear. Stand up for her, defend her, protect her, and present this beautiful girl to Christ. Sandy, the Bible tells you in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 29 to 33, you're to respect what Justin does in your home. You are to be a godly example in this new home, loving him as he loves you. Verse 31 says, "A man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh," an echo from the book of Genesis that reminds us about how God created us. In marriage, the two no longer exist, but one creature in God's eyes. Verse 29 says, "No one ever hated his own body, but he nourishes it and cherishes it just as Christ does the church." Keep on making the difficult choices of love. You could never make a better choice, and God promises to be with you as you make this choice. In Song of Songs, chapter 8, verses 6 to 7, it says, "Set me as a seal upon your heart, as a seal upon your arm, for love is as strong as death, and jealousy is as fierce as the grave." The last part of verse 7 says, "If a man offered all the wealth of his house for love, he would be utterly despised." I want to leave one last passage with you, and that's one that we always look at weddings, and that's 1 Corinthians 13. But I want us also to include the last verse of chapter 12 and the first verse of chapter 14. "I will show you a still more excellent way. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels but have not love, I am but a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith so as to remove mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but it rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I gave up childish ways. Now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, but the greatest of these is love. The next two words of Scripture are simple. Pursue love. Make that choice. Follow that choice the rest of your life. That's what you've come here to do today. You have come here to make vows of that love to each other. So your choice has led you to this moment, and your choice will take you through the rest of your lives together. A vow is a promise about the actions of tomorrow based on the decision of today. In other words, you commit to your choice. So Justin, we'll begin with you. Do you, Justin, take Sandy to be your wife? Do you vow in the presence of God and man to have her and hold her, forsake all others, to love her, cherish her, in sickness and in health, for richer and poorer, for better and worse, from this day forward until death do you part?
I do.
Sandy, Justin has just vowed his commitment to you, and I ask now if you do the same. Do you, Sandy, take Justin to be your husband? Do you vow in the presence of God and man to have and hold him, to forsake all others, to love him and to cherish him in sickness and in health, for richer and for poorer, for better and for worse, from this day forward until death do you part?
I do.
We appreciate the expression of love. We are always moved when we see what God will do. The book of Proverbs says that a threefold cord is not easily broken, and the two of you are promising to intertwine your lives together around the core of God's love, and that is a core that no man can break. Let's pray. Father God, we have just heard these vows made in your presence. We have heard the promise of love, and we have discussed the standard of your love. We pray for Justin and Sandy as they make these vows that you will seal them with your power and with your spirit. We pray that you will keep them focused on you, that you will help them build each other up and bring about glory to your name throughout all the world. Thank you for the love that you show us. Thank you for being a God who is love. It is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Do you have a symbol of the rings? Do you have a symbol of the vows which you have just made?
Yes.
Whoops. Don't worry me like that. A ring is a powerful symbol. It reminds you of the vows you've made. It tells the world about the vows that you've made. It encourages you to be faithful to those vows. The ancients believed that the fourth finger of the left hand contained the vena vita, the vein of life. They believed it was an artery that connected straight to the heart, and the ring serves as the identifier and the guardian of that love, that vein connection. It's pure, the ring is. It's strong, it's endless, the things that you need to be for each other. It's the ideal for your relationship. Wear these rings with pride and thank God for the love that he has given you. So Justin, place this ring on the fourth finger of her left hand and repeat after me. Sandy, with this ring.
Sandy, with this ring.
I pledge myself to you.
I pledge myself to you.
I promise my love and faithfulness.
I promise my love and faithfulness.
My friendship and my heart.
My friendship and my heart.
Forevermore.
Forevermore.
Sandy, take your ring and place it on the fourth finger of Justin's left hand and repeat after me. Justin, with this ring.
Justin, with this ring.
I pledge myself to you.
I pledge myself to you.
I promise my love and my faithfulness.
I promise my love and my faithfulness.
My friendship and my heart.
My friendship and my heart.
Forevermore.
Forevermore.
Amen. Well, you have exchanged rings. You have exchanged vows. We have exchanged scripture readings. Not much stands between you and being married, as far as I can see. So it is my pleasure and my honor, by the authority given to me foremost as a minister of the gospel and recognized by the state of Tennessee, to pronounce you husband and wife. What God has joined together, let no man separate. Justin, you may kiss your bride. I only said once. Sandy, you may now update your Facebook relationship status. I am very proud to present to you for the first time, Mr. and Mrs. Justin and Sandy Neal. On behalf of the family, again, I thank you for being with us today. This was a good day for this whole family, and it was an encouragement to see all of you as we go on to encourage Justin and Sandy in their new relationship. They invite you to the fellowship hall in the basement for a light reception immediately following. The ushers are going to come to dismiss one row at a time so that we don't overwhelm them in the back, and there will be a receiving line for Justin and Sandy as you go out to go towards the basement. Thank you, and you are dismissed.
It is worth it's enough for this wide-eyed wanderer that we've got this far. And can you feel the love tonight? How it's laid.
Ha ha.